Does this apply only for more academic problems, or is it like real life problems? And it's everything, really is everything. But like, I'll have something where I can't figure out a schedule, and I have to go in between several different cities, and how do I get that schedule figured out? Well, if I wait overnight, sometimes in the morning, I'll be like, oh, all I have to do is this. So many different kinds of problems of all sorts of types really can benefit from this. And this is why my own personal rule of thumb is, if there's an important decision, I never say yes immediately. I always wait at least a day. And it's to give that sort of diffuse mode a little bit of time to think about things that I might not have initially thought about. So you might think, though, that, okay, I'm standing here in front of you, and I'm just giving you some really academic stuff. Because who, if you're a teacher, who has time to, okay, now we're going to stop the class while you go into diffuse mode, right? The thing is, what I just spoke about earlier was active learning. So it does give you a chance to kind of alternate modes. But there's another reason why people often have problems with their learning. And that relates to the fact that they procrastinate. You know, we talk about all these things related to learning. And we're always, you know, we talk about deliberate practice and doing things to help students feel relaxed and various techniques, but we don't tackle one of the key problems. And one of the key problems is that students procrastinate. And procrastination is so important, and I'm going to spend just a couple minutes talking about it. When it turns out, when you even just think about something you don't like, it activates a portion of the brain, the insular cortex, that experiences pain. And so, what does your brain do? Your brain sits there and it kind of goes, wait a minute, this feels very unpleasant. So it switches its attention in order to ameliorate those unpleasant feelings. So procrastination happens kind of like this. You it's just a habit, right? And what happens is you pick up something or think about something you don't want to do, like your homework or grading your homework, right? And you get this little unhappy feeling about it. And then, so you just turn your attention to something more pleasant, and the result is that you feel happier almost instantly. Now, you do this once, you do this twice, it's really no big deal. But you do it very often, and it becomes kind of like an addiction. And it can have terrible long-term consequences in your life. Many students who are not successful in certain disciplines, it has absolutely nothing to do with your true abilities to succeed in that discipline. It actually has to do with the fact that they just procrastinated and didn't give it a fair chance. So, since I'm now an engineer, we're going to cut right to the chase. What is the most important way or valuable way to tackle procrastination? And that is the Pomodoro technique. Yes. So how many here have heard of the Pomodoro technique? Hopefully lots of you. And if you haven't, oh, this is so great. And if you have, this is a really good way to do for you. Now, I should point out, so the course I teach, Learning How to Learn, 1.6 million registered students with what, 10,000 more adding each week. And I hear from a lot of these students, more than I probably should ever. And one of the things that I hear most often about is the Pomodoro technique. And students really, really find this incredibly beneficial. And so you should also do this as well. If you can teach your students about this technique, it will be invaluable. So if you have a heavy-duty, hardcore science or engineering course and you don't have a spare second, and you teach about this technique, it will recoup all the time what few minutes it takes for you to teach about this technique. So this technique was invented by an Italian. Dean by Chester Cedillo in the early 1980s. And it's so simple that I think that's part of why people overlook it. But all you have to do is first you turn off all distractions. So, for example, you want to look through your cell phone, you want to know what you're doing, look at your cell phone, or the buzzes that come on. If you're working on your computer, make sure that no other, like, if nothing else can arise, pop up and distract you. So, no sounds, no little pop up bands or anything like that. And for us, it can actually be sometimes kind of difficult to make ourselves do that. The first little while, the first week you might try this, it might be a little bit tough, but it actually, you can fall into it quite quickly. And then, so what you do, you turn off all your distractions, you set the timer for 25 minutes, and so any time, you can just get a little clock timer, there are actually little Pomodoro timers that you can order. I use a little timer that I downloaded onto my laptop. Some people have Pomodoro timers that they use. They're on their smartphones, and it works great. You just, and some people collect them, so they'll be like, I did 3 Pomodoros in my nap today, 2 Pomodoros in the French, and you, whatever. And so once you've done that, then you just practice for 25 minutes. Now, if you are a normal human being, what might for me? I might turn the timer on. I've just done 10 minutes of the time of the Pomodoro. I look up, and I've got 15 minutes left. And my brain goes, I've got 15 minutes left. I just can't do it. And then I let that thought ride on by, and I continue working on the Pomodoro. Because the Pomodoro is not meant that you are going to be focusing perfectly those 25 minutes. It is, you focus as best as you can. Whenever you catch your attention kind of wandering, you bring it back after this, during that time. And then, so when you're done, this is a really important part of the Pomodoro technique. You reward yourself. So why do I say that that's so important? It's because remember before, we always thought that we always thought that if you had something like when you're focusing, you're really trying to pay attention, that's the only time you're learning. But that's just not true. You actually learn effectively, you continue to learn when you turn your attention away and relax. And that gives your brain a chance to do this subconscious processing. So as it turns out, the Pomodoro technique, during that relaxation period, you really get to, you're continuing to learn during that relaxation period. So the only other thing I can say is, don't focus on finishing a task when you're doing the Pomodoro. You want to actually try to make sure that you're focusing on the task, not finishing the task. So you don't want to sit there, well, I'm going to finish all these task frames this evening, during this Pomodoro. No, your whole job is just to work effectively during those 25 minutes. Now, learning has a lot of different aspects, and so I'll just touch on a few of them. One of the most important aspects of learning is that we kind of know that we often neglect is sleep. And sleep, as it turns out, when we're during the day, we're sort of thinking, and metabolites accumulate in our brain. And those metabolites can't escape because our brain cells are like, fluid can't flow past them because the brain cells are like too weird. They're blocking the passage of the cerebral fluid. But when we sleep, our brain cells shrink. When we go to sleep, our brain cells shrink. And that allows the fluids to wash the toxins away. Now we know this, we know that sleep is important, but we still do things like I've seen graduate students don't sleep the night before the phone call comes in. So because we don't know why sleep is important, we often still make the mistake of not sleeping. But sleep is important for another reason, and that is If you look here, this is a light microscopy image of a neuron before learning and before sleep. And what happens after you've learned and slept, this is, this light microscopy is so cool because this is the same exact living neuron after learning and after sleep. And if you look at these yellow triangles, they show new synaptic connections that have been formed. So those connections, this is why it's really important to space your learning out, because you can only form so many synaptic connections of anything. And you don't want to do this business where you're cramming everything in one night. You can only grow so many synaptic connections, and your little metabolic vampires will suck those patterns away before they get very much embedded. I remember once a student came up to me. I actually published an op-ed in the Wall Street Journal about this. This student came up to me and said, I flunked this test. How could I do this? And there's all this red over this test. How could I have flunked this test? I understood it when you said it in class. We've gotten so sort of invested in the idea that conceptual understanding is the only thing that really is necessary for learning, that we've forgotten that practice and repetition are really, really critical in that too. Now, it's a little bit like this. So it's sort of as a metaphorical sense is, good learning allows the motor to drive in between. And if you don't do that, it sort of produces this jump. So I'm going to, I think we only have about 5 minutes left. Is that right?
Yeah.
So I'm going to skip ahead just a little bit. And sorry about this, but so we used to think there were your working memory or short-term memory could hold about 7 items in it. But now we understand it's probably more like 4. And you can actually kind of see those 4, see them in your prefrontal cortex right here. You can see it working really hard. Maybe people are concentrating and trying to remember something in short-term memory. But and so what it's kind of like is when you're focusing on something, it's almost as if you've got this octopus of attention and it can reach through those slots of working memory and make connections into long-term memory. So how do you actually get something from working memory into long-term memory? Well, practice, as it turns out, really does help you improve. That's what builds these sort of patterns. So if you look here, here's when you're first learning something, you form a pattern, and the more you practice and repeat from different perspectives sometimes, the deeper, darker, and richer that pattern becomes. So one of the most important ideas in all pedagogy that is unfortunately neglected relates to the idea of chunking. So what is chunking? If you're first sitting there and you're trying to learn a new pattern or figure out a new concept, it's like a puzzle. And you can actually see your little working memory going crazy. And once you get that sort of puzzle figured out, then it's as if you have chunked that idea into one nice rhythm that's easy to fall into working memory. And here's the key, your other slots of working memory are still free. So you can have students sometimes who will come up to you and say, you know, I suffer from terrible test anxiety. And they actually don't. It's just that they didn't study. And they're still in this stage. So you throw a test at them and they haven't chunked it. And so they panic. That's the first time they realized that they couldn't really do the material. And why would I say that? It's because every time for many decades, I've had a student come up and say, I suffer from test anxiety. If I actually look at the team evaluations of that student, invariably that student didn't actually do the homework, didn't work with the team, and so forth. Every once in a while, there is a person who truly suffers from test anxiety, but it is far less than those who claim to have test anxiety. So I have to show you one little clip before we wrap up here, and that is So we made that massive online course for less than $5,000, which, you know, I mean, there's actually courses out there for hundreds of thousands of dollars. You might ask, how could you make the course so cheaply? That's because I use family members for big parts. And of course, I had my husband as my powerful other half of the team there, and that really was a big help. But so I asked our daughters. I said, hey, I need somebody to model backing up a call really badly. And my younger daughter's like, come on, I can do that. So imagine what it was like when you were first learning to back up a car, if you don't. It is really scary, right? And it's very, very complicated. You're like, now look at her little face. She's like, oh no, which way do I look? Oh, do I look this way or that way? Do I look here or do I wait? No, the wrong way. And then she was off in the ditch. But chunking, I mean, backing up a car is a perfect example of chunking. The first time you try to back up a car, it's crazy. It's confusing. Your little cerebral cortex is going nuts. And then, but once you get it, it's like one solid chunk. You think about back up a car, you can talk to your friends, you can mention this is the radio, it all is easy because you've chunked it. And it isn't just backing up a car, it's anything you're learning. All expertise involves in developing these kinds of chunks. So whether you're learning a language, whether you're playing a musical instrument, learning in math and science. How many times do people do a homework problem, turn it in, and never look at it again? I mean, would you sing a song one time and say, yeah, I knew that song? Never, right? So can you do it with everything? No. So, but you can do it with key ideas. So now, as I'm wrapping up here, I would just like to allude to something that I think is very, very important. There's just like so much more. I actually have more here. But it's all in the MOOC, Learning How to Learn, which is free. So you can go there and you can get many more ideas related to learning. But I think an important topic to consider is the idea of passion. At universities, we're always telling students, follow your passion. The passions develop about what we're good at. And some things take much, much longer to get good at. So I always say, don't just follow your passion. Run your passion. And your lives will be greatly yours. Thank you so very, very much.